Welcome back to AgriTalk Online at Commodity Classic in Tampa, Florida. Joining us now is Rob Elliott from Illinois. He represents the Illinois Corn Growers on the National Corn Growers Association Board. Rob, good to see you again. Corn Congress is going on here. Corn delegates from states around the country meeting to try to set policy, especially looking ahead to that next farm bill. I mean, I'm sure you're getting a lot of different ideas and views representing different parts of the country here.
Oh, we certainly are, and this whole process is certainly a significant one for corn growers, trying to develop what's the next step as we begin to try to educate all those new folks that are in Washington, D.C. And basically, this started last fall or last summer at local and state levels, where they developed their own state policies, which they in turn brought to St. Louis in January to a policy and priority meeting, which then in turn moves here for further discussion. And that's where we've been the last couple of days here, is fine-tuning that policy discussion.
What is the message from Illinois to the national corn growers?
Well, I think what we're entering a budget-limited environment, how do we continue to move forward in an environment like that, particularly with the new group of people that will be determining our destiny? And at the same time, I guess the other part of it is, how do we have enough corn and satisfy all the demand components that we've got out there with ethanol and certainly livestock and exports as well?
I always say a farm bill is more reactionary than visionary, because it's usually dealing with whatever the situation is at that particular time rather than what might lie ahead. This may be a prime example with this next farm bill. If commodity prices stay high, there's that feeling of, well, why have direct payments or why have any kind of support? You've got the high commodity prices. What that doesn't take into account, though, what happens if those prices drop, which we know they will do, we just don't know how much. You have to have something in place in case that happens.
Yeah, prosperity is not here forever. And certainly I think the key focus that corn growers will take is, how do we manage risk and move forward that way? We know prices won't always be high. We know we won't always have high yield, certainly. So how do we manage when income is lower?
I think direct payments will be tough to defend, especially in this environment, but having something in place, we call it a safety net for those not really familiar with how agriculture programs work, something that is there in case there is a big drop in the markets, because what we have seen happen in just the last couple of years, those grain prices can drop, your input costs don't drop nearly as fast, if at all, and then a farmer really gets caught in a squeeze.
Pendulum swing, and typically they always swing too far the other way. And to your point, we can't afford to be caught in a time when input prices have risen, and then all of a sudden we take an income drop, and you're caught in a loss type situation. So creating that safety net that removes that kind of troubling risk factor area is will really be key moving forward.
We're looking at a key crop year coming up with this increased demand. What are you hearing from growers in Illinois? Do you think there will be more corn acres in Illinois this year?
I don't think we'll see dramatic shifts. We came off a year when corn on corn was very challenging. However, I think most folks that are in an environment that can make that happen, they'll continue. And I think the stage is set as well, with tillage and fertilizer being applied and people being ready for springtime, only bodes fairly well for a good crop in the upcoming year.
I think everybody's set for a fast start after the good fall last year. But as you in your area in Western Illinois can certainly attest to, that really still depends on the weather. And if you get another really wet spring like you've experienced in recent times, that can change a lot of plans.
Oh, it can. But right now, I think all odds would point towards a bigger crop in the upcoming year, coming off where we've been. And if we can accomplish a trend line or a shade better crop, we're in line to cover all those demand components and be in pretty good shape.
Let's talk about ethanol for a little bit. There are going to be cuts in the program. There'll be changes in the ethanol program. But that's different than a total elimination, which some are calling for any type of support for the ethanol program, which to me doesn't make sense, especially when we're seeing again right now how vulnerable we are to being dependent on other countries for our energy.
Well, obviously, as we mentioned, we're in a budget-limited environment, so how do we adapt to that and at the same time keep that demand going in a time where the Middle East situation is problematic, possibly? So moving forward, how do we create those demand components that drive ethanol use, like blender pumps, like flex fuel vehicles, that continue to grow that market. So ethanol has a bright future. We just need to adapt with the curveballs that are being thrown at us.
Yeah, the concern here is are these calls that would stop the E15 program, stop investments in blender pumps, and the things that would help get us off of foreign oil.
Yeah, in this whole continuing resolution budget environment that people are looking at things a bit differently, some of the logic has fell apart here just a little bit. So I think that will be part of our job is how do we create the right reality that people are making decisions for the right reasons.
What I've been saying is there's a big difference between cutting a program and cutting out a program.
Right, absolutely. And I think we're all ready, willing, and able to change and look at things a bit differently. But at the same time, we have to create an environment where we've got jobs, we got profitability, we got energy security, we got all those things going that make sense.
I find it interesting too. I've been talking and writing about this a lot. We're at a time now there's so much criticism focused on ethanol about because of tight stocks. It wasn't that long ago agriculture was criticized for surpluses and being paid not to produce and things. I mean, isn't this what we were striving for, to have create a greater value for our products and have a demand for our products? That's what we were working for, wasn't it?
We've been working for the last 20 or 30 years to get out of, you know, a subsidized market where we're on the edge of profitability and striving to keep heads above water. But I don't think anybody's going to apologize now for making a buck, because when a farmer makes a buck, he reinvests in his business. You buy a new combine or tractor or spend your money that keeps other people working across the economy. So,
and just to be clear, because someone could be listening saying, now, wait a minute, are you talking out of both sides of your mouth? You're saying on the one hand, hey, you've got high prices, so you don't have to have the government payments, but on the other hand, you're saying you're concerned about a cut in government payments. Again, what we're talking about is a safety net, just something there in case the prices do drop.
It's about balance, and that's all that we're looking for is let's keep the good portions of our economy going and then not let them falter because of an outside force that unforeseen, let's say.
Good to see you again.
You bet. Always a pleasure.
Rob Elliott from Illinois, a member of the National Corn Growers Association Board of Directors. All right, we'll take a break. Much more to come from here at Commodity Classic in Tampa, Florida. This is AgriTalk Online.